What did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
All Jedi had was a bunch of Muppets.
Boring conversation anyway.
Hey, Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. We're back. We're starting a new year right, jumping into Star Wars. We've got a big show for you today. And, of course, I got to do it with my two good friends. Let's throw it to Brian first. Brian, how you doing?
I was told that I didn't have to interact with Thor anymore, and this is kind of, this is a bunch of bull, and I'm walking. I'm out. This is not for me anymore.
Well, did you take notes?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Oh, then
I'm sure the only one here who did.
We desperately need you then, yes. So, Thor, how you doing? How's it been? What's going on?
Doing good.
Yeah? Tell everybody what you got for Christmas.
Oh, the Lego set.
Yeah.
What's the name of it? I forgot.
Cad Bane's ship. We'll just go with that.
Yeah, it's Cad Bane's ship.
Yeah.
From like the finale of the Bad Batch, the first season. So it's got Cad Bane.
Not quite the finale.
I think it's from the finale.
Like mid-season.
Was it?
Yeah.
It was towards the end of the season, yeah.
All right. I think there was 16. I'll give you 9, somewhere in that range.
Wait, weren't they in Topeka City, right?
Yeah, but
yeah, Camino,
go back.
Yeah.
Cad Bane did not go to Camino.
No?
No, he went to... It was an abandoned facility. It was an abandoned facility. I just did a rewatch of the Bad Batch because we knew Bad Batch 2 was coming out. So... First, you have what's
you have?
You have not enough, but luckily I could do things at work, like a half hour show every now and again, so you could bang it out. Fennec Shan was there first, right, to get Omega, and then Cad Bane was after her too. So that was kind of like right. I don't remember the exact episode number, but it was kind of in the middle. You know, the last maybe 4 episodes were really good in The Bad Batch, where it was really setting up everything for the future of what was going on and how it was changing from the clones to the TKs and whatnot, and that was pretty cool. So yeah, that is a cool set. How many minifigs in that set?
So it's got Hunter, Omega, Cad Bane, Fennec Shand, and then the robot, the Cad Bane's robot.
Okay, okay. So now, do you feel the need to go find the rest of the Bad Batch in Lego, or are you okay just having Hunter?
No, I would want the rest of them.
Right.
But I don't know if I'll get there. I like the airship, though, so that would be
nice
to have.
I want that. Remember the micro-galaxy that I showed you with the Falcon and then a little of the baby ships in the micro-galaxy? Yeah.
Yeah, they have
the Bad Batch in that. I'd like to get in that one, because I'm never going to see it for Hasbro. So... Did you get anything cool for Christmas, Brian?
Not really. Nothing Star Wars related.
No. Well,
I got a nice windbreaker from Columbia for the next time I go hiking. So I'm legitimately excited about that.
Is that a Star Wars Columbia windbreaker?
No, because those were stupid expensive, and I tried to get those, and I couldn't get them.
Well, weren't you trying to get a sweatshirt, though, or something like a hoodie?
Yeah.
How much was the hoodie?
It's like $120. Yeah.
You slap Star Wars in anything, and it's just gold, man. So, I didn't get anything for Christmas because, you know, my kids don't get me anything, my wife doesn't get me anything because I get my stuff year-round. Same with my wife, so we really never exchange. But, I got a delivery before Christmas. I got the rescue set.
Oh, yeah, it's Mando rescuing Baby Yoda from Moff Gideon.
Yes, it's the end of season 2. And it's a great set. I think it was the Hasbro Con exclusive or something like that. But it's ridiculously overpriced. To count Grogu as a figure, you're really stretching things now. I mean, he's more of an accessory. What's really cool about this is like the Dark Trooper, you can take the Beskar spear, put it through its neck, comes out the other side. It looks really cool like that. And then the, those whistling birds?
Yeah.
He has one that you can keep on, so we're talking 3 3/4, so you can see everything's tiny. He has one that you could put into his wrist that's just like set ready to fire, and then you have another add-on that's all the flames coming out of it. So that was pretty cool. And there's a lot of fire effects that go on to the Dark Trooper. I would have added Luke and R2 to this set, and then it would have been a six set, you know, but not much going on in the news of Star Wars, except they've been talking about the massive game, which is going to get some details about it in the next couple of months. And that's the huge MMO game, so I can't wait for that one, actually. I'm looking forward to that. I know we have the second Cal Kestis game coming out, and that looks cool, too. I think Connor already pre-ordered it. Oh, also Connor, you know, he got a job during Christmas selling Christmas trees and did pretty good. So now he wants to buy an Oculus.
How much money did he make over Christmas? Jesus Christ.
He did pretty good, actually. He did really good on tips. And he says to me, he goes, you know what I figured out? And I was like, what's that? He goes, married women are lonely. So if you're just really nice to them, you get better tips. I was like, holy.
Is that all you'll get from him, Connor?
I know. Yeah. So like, oh man, crazy. But yeah, and I had Thor's Oculus for probably like 2 months, and it was absolutely amazing. So I'm excited he's going to get it, because I'll be playing on that. Oh, so Thor gives it to me and says, you should test it. You can't test it when it's bright out. You can't use it outside when it's bright. So if you get cloud coverage, or if it's just no sun day, you could use it in the yard. So I mapped out the yard and played the Star Wars game, which takes place, like, I guess it's Batuu or whatever, in the woods. And I'm wearing just, you know, shorts and a t-shirt, no shoes. So I'm in the game, I'm walking on grass. And I must have played for like 2 hours. And then the next day, my neighbor comes over and goes, hey, man, what were you doing? He goes, I just kept on seeing you shooting things with your hands. It was really weird. And I was like, this is a really cool game, man. So, Brian, what are we talking about today?
We're talking about Bad Batch Season 2, Episodes 1 and 2.
Yes. All right. Let's just jump into Episode 1. What was your overall thoughts?
I liked them. I thought they were both fine.
Yeah, that's where I'm at. Fine. Yeah. Fine. Yeah. Thor?
What?
Welcome back, baby! What did you think of the Bad Batch overall, these two episodes? By the way, did you watch all of the Bad Batch last year?
Yeah, I watched most of it with you.
You did.
We watched a lot of it together.
Brian wasn't. That's right. Because I know we did all the Boba Fett together. Yeah, yeah. Another one. You were happy we were covering. So that's right. You did stick through all Bad Batch. Okay. So what'd you think of these two?
It was fine.
Yeah. That's
it was just like not particularly interesting, but not like visually very impressive. I love that tropical planet and the giant crabs, and I love the whole thing with the cargo containers, like that whole business.
Okay.
It was pretty good. It wasn't like, it was fine.
It's fine. I'm
like
right
seeing
there.
Where they are. I like their, I think I like it. I don't know. I don't know how I feel about their costumes, but.
Yeah, the costume change. I was going to ask you about that.
I like that they changed it a lot.
You like those changes?
Yeah. Like, I like a lot that they changed it.
Okay.
Because it never sat right with me that they're still running around in like their standard issue.
Yeah.
Armor that they just like fought a war in. Like, be a little more inconspicuous.
Right.
So even just like adding the orange, it's like, okay, something different.
Listen, all I care about is, you know, we have Hunter's finally coming out, you know, after the Black Series got all of them, Hunter's finally coming out, and it would be just like Hasbro to give me Hunter in season one, another guy in season one, and then two or three more guys from season two. You know what I mean? So it's like, just stick to the season and I'll be fine. Yeah. Yeah, I'll go along with you guys. It's stunning. It looks gorgeous. It's just, at this point, you know, it's some of the best animation you're ever going to see. So it's great. I think 16 episodes on a show like that might be a little much, but at the same time, this show, you know, we could watch it, but it's not geared for us. It's geared for kids. You know, it's like Mike, you know, Cousin Mike. And by the way, we got to figure out a shirt for Cousin Mike. I think that was Cousin Mike's shirt when we start selling our shirts again. I just had that idea today because I always bring him up.
Here's a shirt idea for Cousin Mike. Yeah. It's just an empty chair.
Yeah, exactly. With a broken microphone or something. So, He's like, dude, it's like we were growing up. He goes, G.I. Joe is the same thing. 75,000 shots are being fired and nobody gets killed. He goes, that's the way it is. In the second episode, though, you know, you look at it, they did kill a bunch of clones. And we'll get into it.
I have questions about it that we'll get into.
I have a question for you because I need someone medically to answer that question for the second episode. But we'll get into that. Yeah,
we're going
to
get into that.
Yeah.
With that.
All right, great. So, all right, episode one.
Spoilers of war.
Spoilers of war, yes.
Yeah, they start off on that whatever tropical planet that is, running from the giant crabs.
Right.
And they stole a big crate from the giant crabs.
Right. Do we ever really see what's in it? I don't think we do. No.
No, it's a MacGuffin. Neat looking
a big
crabs.
Pearl.
Makes sense.
I like the giant crabs, though. Like, I'm all excited to see more just, like, monsters in Star Wars.
Okay, okay. Yeah, it looked cool.
Like, it reminded me of King Kong, like the Peter Jackson one. You know where they fall into that ravine?
Yes, yeah.
First off, I love that scene because it's terrifying. But
did you like that movie? That's what it reminded me. Did you like that movie overall, the Peter Jackson King Kong?
Tangent here for a second. I watched the 1933 one for the first time last week.
Oh.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. It's Logan. Logan loves that movie.
It's very much a product of its time.
Yes.
But I can respect how much it has influenced filmmakers.
It influenced
as we know him.
It influenced everybody that worked on Star Wars. If you watch Light and Magic, they always talk about King Kong, mm-hmm. about seeing it on TV.
Good that we don't have to.
This whole thing is called boring conversation, and Thor always hates when we go on side tangents, but that's what Brian and I do all the time, man. Real quick about King Kong. Do you know that when you watch the movie, you see the fur is moving? Did you ever notice that?
Yes, but I know what you're going to say, and it doesn't.
What's that?
It doesn't look like the wind is blowing. All right, it doesn't. This is a bunch of bull. I've been hearing this for 30 years.
No, it does. It looks
there's
great.
There's one shot where the monkey or King Kong is climbing up the building to steal Ann Darrell out the window. That's the only shot where it looks like the wind is blowing.
But do you know why the fur is moving in the first place?
Yeah, because it's stop motion, so they had to keep adjusting.
When their thumbs were going back and forth with the model. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, right. But when he's fighting the T-Rex, it just looks like his hair has like a mind of its own. It doesn't. It does not.
Why do you think Logan loves that movie? Why do you think Logan loves that movie? I think Thor could get this. Why do you think Logan watches King Kong over and over again? What scene do you think it is?
I know the answer to this.
You do, right? Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is it where the guy says he doesn't like women on ships because they're a nuisance? Is
no,
that it?
Yeah, that's it. No. It's the subway train when he knocks the subway train over.
Subway train.
That's a good call.
Because you know him with trains, right? So he watches constantly. Maybe 4 or 5 years ago at this point, we had a Thanksgiving and it was up here. So when we came back home, he wanted to watch it. And I put a big sheet, because I had a projector, I put a big sheet across the living room, and we sat there and watched. It was really cool, black and white, that big. It was nice, yeah. So, hey, check us out on our new podcast, King Kong 1933, What We Learned. So
it would just be you telling that same fact over and over again.
about the front.
What? As much as I would like to move on, we didn't get an answer to the question of whether or not you like that movie, Brian.
33?
No, the new one.
The new one.
Or the Peter Jackson one. It's not new anymore, but
It's bloated.
Yeah, that's how
I
felt.
It's just I could cut 20 minutes out of the movie, and I think it'd flow a lot better.
I kind of.
That being said, watching it, I could tell how much Peter Jackson loved the original.
Yes.
By, like, recreating scenes, even if they got cut, or, like, putting in specific lines of dialogue, or
I feel like that one takes forever to get to the island, right?
Oh, yeah.
It takes him a while.
But it takes a while to get to the island in 33, too, by the way. But not as long as the Peter Jackson one.
No, not nearly as long. But I also like, it's just how women are treated in movies in the 30s.
Okay, wait. I'm like, that? Or you?
No. Okay, No, but it's messed up. And it's whatever. It's what it was at the time. It's just... Oh, and Daryl was kidnapped by this ape, and now she's traumatized and worried. Like, oh no, this is a woman being dramatic. Whatever.
Oh,
whatever. Or
All right. Oh, well, we're going to stay on this for a minute. Did you guys see the one from the 70s?
No. I've seen He Climbs the Twin Towers.
Yes.
Yeah, I know that much about it, but I've never seen it.
And I believe that one, I think that guy is a guy in a suit. It's not the stop motion in that one.
Oh, really?
I'm pretty sure, yeah. Yeah. So, So,
oh, I did like how Peter Jackson actually gave King Kong like a personality.
I really thought when I first saw that in the theater, I thought there was a chance that the friggin' monkey was going to say something. I really did.
Yeah, yeah. But just that's absent from the first movie. Like, it's a monster movie.
Right. Of course. Yeah. But. Yeah. All right. We're losing Thor. So let's get into it. Yeah.
Giant crabs. Yeah.
Giant crabs.
So.
All right. They get whatever they need to get, and they go back to Ormantel. Looking to see Sid, and instead of seeing Sid, there's someone else behind the desk, and we learn who this person is.
Wanda Sykes.
No idea. Yeah, Wanda Sykes. They're a very unique voice.
Yeah, it's just idiot. Yeah, it's
I love Wanda Sykes.
It's Star Wars Wanda Sykes.
Yeah.
It's Fee Genoa.
So she's a pirate, right?
I mean, I thought it was a type of salami, but yeah.
Genoa salami.
Yeah, Genoa salami.
I always say Genoa.
How's it pronounced? You guys are Italian.
What did you call?
Sometimes.
He looks so shocked. We have to break him out of there, man. You got. All right, we're gonna have to schedule it because I keep telling you, and you never want to. You know, I know you don't want to invite yourself over, so we're gonna have to schedule a day for you to come over because you're looking like you're in prison. Everything's you're growing out.
I'm tired. I'm tired today, but
yeah. Are you allergic to your cat, by the way?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, but you are allergic to cats, right?
I'm allergic to most things. I feel like I can eat
love
anything,
and intimacy and care. Yeah. I'm more allergic to that.
Responsibility,
commitment, show notes. All right.
Anyways, let's keep going.
Keep it going.
Yeah, we meet Wanda Sykes, but then, like, she just kind of, like, she takes the chest and walks away. Or she has Hunter, or she has Wrecker carry the chest and walk away.
Right,
well,
right,
she gave,
right.
She tipped them off on the job. What do you want her to do, jumping jacks?
I mean, I'm going to assume she's going to come up later in the series.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, maybe. She could do jumping jacks, why not?
We see AZ-3 is there, too. I think that's his name, the droid from the last season.
Yeah, yeah.
So of the last survivors from Topeka City? What was it? I always found
Tropic
that weird.
City?
Yeah. Huh? I always thought that was so weird, but yeah. So, all right. And now Sid wants him to do another job, correct?
Yeah, she wants him to go to Castle Serrano. Because that's Count Dooku's old... Sid wants him to go to Castle Serrano because that's Count Dooku's old home. So right. Now the Empire is going there and taking possession of everything he owns because, well, he's dead and he lost the war, so it's theirs now.
And he has a ton of riches that the Empire can use to do what they're doing, so it makes sense. She wants him to do it. Hunter doesn't want to do it. Then they talk to everybody else but Hunter. Now they all want to do it, so they're going to go do it. And... this is where it just gets, you know, like, weird for me. It seems like this is an when they get there, and you're like, I know if it was me and Thor, the minute we pulled in and we saw they were all loaded up, all three of them, they're ready to go, we're like, all right, this is over. There's no reason to even be here right now. The first one's already flying away before they get going. So I was just like, Hunter screamed about how hard this was, but then when they get there, they're like, oh, you know, let's just do it anyway, see what happens.
I mean, if you travel that far, you may as well make the effort. They've already had the plan, and they knew the Empire was going to be there to begin with.
Right.
So why not? Like, I'm just going to say, what do they have to lose? But they a lot.
Yeah. We go back though to that beach planet. What Omega? She's got a new hat now. She looks a little older. The hair is different, so we know that time has passed. She's studying ships. So I found that was pretty cool. Sure, I'm sure she was doing it for a reason, which we'll find out in episode 2 why she was doing it. But yeah, so
they're training her to be a clone.
Right.
I assume they're training her how they were trained, more or less.
Oh, that's interesting.
What do you think they were doing?
I just thought they were just...
Here's a book on ships. Read up, kids. I just
thought it was busy to keep her mouth shut so they could do stuff.
It comes through later on when she knows that information about the thing, that they have the
re-entry jets rockets, or whatever. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I'd say that's actually still in the first episode, right? Because it's literally, it's on the cliffhanger after it breaks apart. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I just thought they were giving her busy work. He's like, what are we going to do with this kid this whole time? She just doesn't shut up, so let's let her stare at some ships for a while.
Sorry. I got to say something about Omega. Her bow and arrow blaster thing, very unique, very different. Feels wildly, implausible as a weapon in Star Wars. Like, I feel like...
Wait,
too big and cumbersome and fires too slowly to be useful to them.
I think I give this a little bit of thought, and I think it's part of me in my head thought maybe it's a BB gun, you know what I mean? They don't want to give a real weapon. BB gun can hurt, you know, but my other thing is that it's compact because it doesn't actually have a string or bows. It just she just kind of pulls at it, almost I don't know, if you're doing it in VR or something, you know. I've ever played a game like that, but I think it's if it can control the how fast the a bow and arrow could, right? You draw back further, it's going to go faster and farther. If you don't, it won't. So maybe there's advantages like that. Like in close quarters, though, obviously, just having a trigger would probably be better.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I think it's kind of neat, though.
I think it's neat. I think Brian. That's cool. I understand what you're saying. I mean, it's a Star Wars cartoon. I think if it was in a show or a movie, I'd be like, okay, that doesn't really work because you're going to get hemmed up pretty fast.
Yeah, I'm picking logic holes in a cartoon. What is my life?
I think it could have a tactical advantage.
Where's my life? You think it could have a tactical advantage?
Well, just what I described.
You're saying that she doesn't have to have that much force when she's stringing the harp almost, when she's pulling it back? So how's it tactical? Because she could do it faster if she wanted to?
Well, I imagine it wouldn't take any effort at all because she's not actually pulling on anything, it doesn't feel except like. It feels like the weapon was created to imitate a bow.
Well, season 1, they make a big deal about how she was doing it and she wasn't doing it right. And then Sid told her how to keep her arm tight and then that was it. So I don't know if that has anything to do with it pressure-wise. But yeah, I mean, the way she's going through it, it's almost kind of like Legolas when he's using digital arrows in the movie, so he's doing it super fast. So I mean, she's getting really good at it, and she's not afraid, and they're letting her in on more of these missions already, which is cool because the first season was more about you're not doing this because I want to protect you kind of thing. So I think that's going to different places. I like the weapon because it looks really cool and it's different. Everybody else has got blasters, and we're gonna get into that. Or back to using the stuns, right? Because what it looks like to me is that anytime they're going to go up against clones, which is their brothers, they're going to stun them. You got to wonder how long the stunning lasts, because I don't know, Leia's pretty much up and running to go yell at Vader in the hallway after they shoot her. So I don't know how long it lasts, but they do fall back to that stun again. But at the same time, these episodes combined showed that they were not afraid to kill them if they had no other choice.
I was about to say, Wrecker shot down 2 aircrafts.
3.
It was 3?
Yeah. So he rips out the thing out of the tank, which he uses as a bazooka with the battery, and shoots the aircraft right away. Then when he later on jumps into the Marauder and he's in the back, he shoots down at least 2 that way.
Yeah.
And then Tech, with the broken leg and all, shoots down, what do they call that gunship?
The gunship.
It's just called a gunship?
The Republic gunship.
It's not a L-A-A-T?
Jesus, I don't know.
Okay. You're talking about who has a life now. So, and Tech shoots that down. And then, also, Wrecker is going along with that bazooka thing, and he's just leveling rocks and blowing up guys.
He's shooting at guys.
Yes. So
why are we using all the screw it? Let's get into it now. Why are we going out of our way to use these stuns if Wrecker's just blowing people to smithereens?
That's where it was getting a little dicey there. It's like, okay, I have to look at it this way, Brian. As like I said, they're going to stun when they can. But if it's between them and themselves getting alive, they're going to pick their team, obviously, and they're going to kill them.
I mean, I feel like that's any firefight.
Right, right.
Something.
Yes. I just think I'm saying is that's like what it's worth. I feel like in the world of cartoon violence, surviving explosions is kind of likely. A lot of times, like when someone throws a grenade or a rocket launcher or something, there's a big and the bodies go flying, but they
get up. Yeah, except those ships really just crashed right into something and were like on fire. So I think it was a little.
They got airbags.
Yeah. All right, where we're at in the episode now?
Oh, Hunter goes and plants like
he's doing charges some assaults to plant charges in the what were those ships called? Do you remember?
V-wings,
yeah. And the clones used those, right? Those were not ever used by the Jedi. Those were definitely just used by the clones, right?
Yeah, that's clone ships.
I have a broken V-wing that someone gave me, and I took it because I can't say no to Star Wars. But like, what am I going to do? It's missing half of it, but whatever. Okay. Then, while Hunter's doing that, the rest of the team are going into one of the vaults here to find the cargo to see all the stuff they can get. And they find a ton of loot, treasure, whatever you want to call it, shiny stuff. And all that, as that's happening, it goes up. And was it Tech or it's Echo have the idea of we could just take a... What do you call it? Help me out, Brian.
An escape hatch.
Escape, yeah, yes. Yeah. So they take, but they the clones are smart, so they blow those all out. But Omega, being studying up on all these ships, she knew that if you just get into one of these pods, it's going to re-enter the atmosphere and you're going to be fine. And
yeah, it's got like re-entry boosters, yes. So it doesn't just slam into the earth.
And that's where they end the episode.
How much would you have loved if episode 2 just started with that crate slamming into the ground and those three being dead? That would have been a great plot twist for the season.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's just the next 14 episodes are Wrecker and Hunter dealing with their grief.
God. All right, so we come to the next episode and we're watching this thing fall from the sky, and then finally the boosters come on, and then it lands, but of course it has to land on a cliff, and then it's not done, and they're moving around inside, trying to get out, and it falls again, and then finally they get out. What we got going on after that, Brian?
Well, the first episode, Hunter and Wrecker, they climb onto the freighter, and then they jump off onto the castle, and they get pinned down inside, yes. His like command room,
his like throne room. The throne. Yeah, yeah, it was really cool seeing that castle, especially if you. I mean, if, you know, you watch Clone Wars, you've seen that set before. It was really cool. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed that. Yeah, and they're gonna get out by there's like an elevator behind his desk that they're gonna.
Yeah, and it takes them down to the whatever. This is his landing platform.
Sure,
and you get a great view of like the leveled city.
Mm-hmm.
Outside, which really it looked like Germany,
yeah, in
1945. Just nothing left.
Banged up, and you know, they when they get there, they got the view a little bit of that view in the beginning of the episode when they land there, and Omega asks where that came from, and Echo's the one who answers. It was just like Kamino was an orbital strike, and that's what they did. So you got, and then you got to see a close up with these guys now, and they're running through it too, right? Because that's how they're escaping.
Yeah, I kept forgetting that was the bombed out city and not just like a canyon.
Pretty sure it was the bombed out city.
Yeah. No, it was because you could see some like crash buildings in the background.
Both of these episodes just bleed in together, and it probably could have been one episode. You know, I think
that's why they put them out.
I mean, last year they gave us one episode, like 1 hour episode as the first episode, and then it was 15 more. I think they just took the 1 hour, cut it in half, and gave us one and two at the same day.
Fine. I'm okay with it. It's the same thing to me.
Yeah, I get it. So, All right, keep it going, brother.
They're cutting corners too, all right? They're working. Well, those animators are working hard.
As they've been keep saying now, the days of the glory days of the streaming services are done now. They're not going to spend the money like they used to because the returns aren't happening. So,
well, make something I want to watch and I'll buy your streaming service. So they crash on the cliff and then they crash further off the cliff and then Tech breaks his femur.
Yeah. Okay. Being a man in the medical world, a broken femur. How much are you walking around on that without anything?
Thor's wearing a shirt that says medicine. So why don't you feel that one, Thor?
Yeah, you can walk on it pretty good. Pretty good. As long as you don't overdo it.
Okay. Thor, what bone is the femur?
It's the leg bone.
Okay, I'm gonna have to be a little more specific than that, buddy. There's more than a couple bones.
Between the knee and the foot.
Nope. And for the record,
between the knee and the.
I knew that was coming. I knew that was coming.
It is correct. And for the record, there's two bones between your knee and your foot. But okay. Yeah. Breaking your femur is a huge deal.
Yeah.
Like, maybe Hunter's like genetically altered. And, like, maybe he can withstand, like, a crazy amount of pain. But him walking on that is unimaginable to me.
Let me just step in here as a medical professional. I don't recall him saying that it was, like, broken. Like, I think he just, like, broke it a little bit.
No, that's what he said. He said, my femur broke over 150 kilos of pressure, so I'm not fine. That's what he said.
All right. But to be fair, that armor he's got could give him some support. Cool. Some support. Maybe enough, you know?
Cool. But you know what happens when you break your femur? So, whatever. No one listening is going to see this. But it breaks. So it breaks apart like that. And then it retracts onto itself. So it shortens.
Oh, ow.
Yeah.
Ow.
That's why, like, when you fix it, you have to hold, like, manual stabilization and pull it, like, apart. Because the muscles in your leg are so tight, like that's what it's like keeping your body together.
Have you had to set someone's leg up like that when you're?
I don't think so.
Okay. Right.
No, but I've had enough like tib fib fractures where I'm just like, this is like the most horrific thing I've ever seen in my life. Where like just the leg is pointing a different direction. I'm like, oh, you're getting pain meds. I don't care what you say. You're getting fentanyl.
All right.
Yeah, but yeah, he, whatever. I'm picking logic out of a cartoon again.
I know.
Because I'm 31 and single, and this is what I have in my life. But yeah, so they drag him up the cliff somehow. And
yeah.
They finally meet Romar.
Oh, he actually had a name. I thought his name was Survivor.
I mean, he says his name is Romar.
Okay. All right.
And then he takes him to
his house.
They force him to take him.
Because they can read they can read heat measurements from 200 meters away.
Yeah.
And then you can see that Omega the whole time was preoccupied with something. And the guy's showing her around. He's supposed to be – she has to watch. She wants to go get the treasure. And Echo's like, no, there's patrols. We're not messing with it anymore. Just let it go. She goes down to the basement with him and he's picking through garbage. And he's like, hey, I was going to throw this out. Do you want to see this kaleidoscope? And she thought it was jewels, which I thought was cute. And she's looking through it. And this is where I was. I mean, I get it. I was working a lot. So I was working, watching it at night. But I was just like, whoop, rewind 10 seconds. See what I just missed. You know what I mean? And at the same time, Hunter, you know, they're cutting back and forth. Hunter and Wrecker are just, you know, stunning and killing troopers as they go through things. So, you know, that's what they keep doing. They keep going back and forth. And then Echo goes to check on patrols. And when he gets back, Omega's gone.
I don't 100% get why Omega wanted the treasure that badly.
Well, yeah,
so
go ahead.
I think overall, there's a sense of, like, we've got to complete the mission. Like, that, the completing the mission is the most important thing. And she's driven by that. Which I think comes perhaps maybe just from, like, you're young, and being young, you're sort of a little less cautious, you know. So they're saying, hey, it's not worth it, and I think that's part of it. And the other part of it too is And this is something that I didn't love because I thought it was kind of like, I just like, where did that come from? And like, it's a little cliche is the old, like, she starts feeling bad that she like ruined these guys' lives. Essentially, she's feeling tremendous guilt over a conversation. I think it's in the first episode she hears between Hunter and
and just the like the cliche, guy. She only hears the first part of the conversation and doesn't get that what Echo is trying to say is no. She changed our lives, but it was the right thing to do, and we need to do it for more people and not just be sitting here trying to make a living and survive. We need to help people. But she didn't get any of that because why did she want to stick around? And it's hard, too, on that ship because she's in her maid bedroom that they made for her, which has got like a sheet that blocks it. So it wasn't like she went into another room and didn't hear the rest of it. So it was a little bit – I get it.
So I think part of her is also operating on like, I've got to prove my worth. And she knows how big this mission is, that, you know, because that's the other thing that they hype up is like, this could be the last one, you know, you'll get so rich from this one, you don't have to take anymore. But I thought it was a little bit weird because at times it just felt like maybe she was more just consumed by like material wealth. Like she was like really into like, we got to get the treasure. Are these jewels in this thing? You know, I don't know.
Well,
that's a weird place. Yeah. Where would that come from?
What they're going to say is because she's only thinking of one thing. She just wants to make it up, especially to everybody, because she thinks maybe everybody feels the way Echo feels, which he really didn't feel that way, but we'll not cover that again. I mean, it's like a loop of what's going on, right? So I didn't get that. I got that she just wanted to do this because she really wanted to, you know, one, prove her worth, and two, prove that what they did was the right thing and that, you know, their life wouldn't be changed forever. No matter what, their life is changed forever. And I don't know how this show is going to end. I mean, I always have this thing that it's just going to be Hunter and Omega left at the end of the show, but it's also, again, a bunch of kids watching it, so I don't know how many they're going to pop off in a kids show. You know what I mean? So, I don't know.
I mean, they killed Kanan in Rebels.
Oh, spoiler,
whoa,
man.
Spoilers.
He didn't get up that far. You know how long I've been dancing around Rebels with him?
Shut up.
They also killed Yoda in Star Wars A New Hope.
No, they didn't.
Never mind.
I don't want to talk about all right. You remember how I found out that I was just really, really hell bent on this guy? Oh, I should probably bleep that out too. The holsters. And then I found out that there was no holsters in Empire or Jedi, just barely any.
I have to hear this guy talk about holsters one more time.
How about red light Jawas?
What?
Red, you know, the red eye Jawas that we have in the off world planets from Mandalorian. Well, I'm watching, falling asleep to Star Wars, like I always fall asleep to one of the six movies, and all of a sudden I couldn't sleep that well, so I'm up to the point where the Jawas are going to scoop up R2, and there's just two scenes of two Jawas in the cave before they get them. They're not out yet, they're in the cave, the eyes are red. It's nothing new anymore, everything's just reused over and over again.
Aren't they supposed to be, like, yellow or orange?
They are, yeah, except in the caves, they were red eyes.
Maybe this was a dream you had.
Who knows if they're not red eyes the whole time, but because they're in the sun of Tunisia, they're shooting out yellow. I don't know. No, it wasn't a dream, because I paused it, then rewind it, checked it again, and then put a note on my phone, tell Thor. Hey, this is what you get, man.
So let me get this straight.
Yeah.
In your sleep-deprived,
yep,
late-night drunken state,
not drunken,
you saw
state,
this,
no,
yeah, and went, Thor's going to care about this.
Here's the thing. When I watch, let's talk about, no, because I just like to, I love to tell these things to Thor. Well, he actually had good opinions about the holsters. Like, you know, how do you feel?
No, he didn't. He made fun of you.
Yeah, I know, but it was still pretty cool. It was pretty funny. When it's funny, I give him credit for it, all right? You know what I mean? So I figured he'll find something good about this one. But the thing is, I don't usually get past – if I get past Leia getting stunned in that one, then it's going to be a bad night. I know that for a fact. It's going to be a bad night. So
– oh, I see what you mean.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you right now, there's an easy way to fall asleep.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh God.
No.
Okay.
I finally figured out a trick to fall asleep, and it's worked for me for the past like couple years. Play the movie in your head.
Okay.
Like, just start memorizing scenes of like, first we get to this, and then the kiss of that, and that, and that, and you'll be out before you get to lay again stunned.
Oh, okay.
Because I do that every night with Jurassic Park, and I've never made it past the lawyer getting into the cave.
I'm out like, that's like the first 5 minutes,
man. Yeah. Yeah, so it works.
I was expecting you to say you do it every night with American History X. Just out like a light.
Gosh. Actually, I just watched that movie again last week.
Did you now?
First time in a couple years.
I've actually never really seen all of it. It's got the dad from Boy Meets World in it, so I want to see it. He's my favorite actor.
Who's the dad in Boy Meets World?
I don't know. I don't know his name.
Who's he playing in American History X?
He's the dad. He's like their dad.
Okay. Oh, spoiler alert. Dad gets killed in a fire, so he's really not in that movie at all.
You can't say spoiler. They just proceed to... like.
Yeah, spoiler alert lets you know that it's coming.
Yeah, spoiler alert. That's how Ed Norton becomes a neo-Nazi. That's the triggering moment, is his relationship with his father.
Speaking of Ed Norton, so we can get off of this movie, he's in Glass Onion. He's really good in it.
Yeah, yeah, thanks. That's breaking news for nobody.
Oh my god! Well, you know what?
You know a lot of edits, like, Chris.
You can edit this thing.
Really, none of us want to talk about it.
I love that movie. I thought Glass Onion was incredible.
The star.
Did you really like Glass Onion?
On Netflix right now.
I knew exactly who the bad guy was in the first 3 minutes of that movie. So to me, it wasn't a great movie then.
Yeah, but the reveal is funny. It doesn't matter if you know who it is.
Yeah.
It's the journey to get there.
Oh, okay.
I feel like all of my negativity has really rubbed off on Campbell.
I was about to say, this is a dark world where I'm the positive one.
I liked it. I think it's... I like the first one better, though.
Yeah, I like the first one better as well. I'll give it another one.
Saw the first one.
Why?
Oh, it's good.
If you haven't known, my wife's name is Negative Nelly, so... watching a movie with her is sometimes brutal. Like, earlier today, we were putting on, just sitting there waiting to record, and she goes, you want to watch something? I said, yeah, I've been hearing about this RRR movie from India on Netflix. Everybody says it's great. And I watched it with her for a half hour, and I know she's never going back to that movie again. So I'll be able to do that one on my own, because she was just like, nope. And I thought it was pretty cool. I did. Did you get to see that one, Brian?
No, okay. Not yet.
But you heard about it, right?
Yes, a lot of people I've known have told me to watch it.
So, all right, we're off the rails here. Let's get back to Star Wars.
Where were we?
Omega's greed for diamonds.
Yeah.
She wants to upgrade her bedroom. She wants to replace a sheet with an actual door.
She has a very Last Crusade moment.
Yes. Yeah, I thought that too. I thought that was so Last Crusade, man.
Well, and Echo says
the same thing.
Yes. Echo says you need to leave it, right? Something like that. Is it you need to leave it behind? Something like that.
Yeah, forget about it. Yeah. Like,
very
you're
close.
You're more important than the money. Yeah. Which is also kind of weird that Dooku still has like physical money around, but okay. But someone with that much wealth would it all be electronic.
It must have been Bitcoin, but actually, that's a topical joke. I don't know what Bitcoin is.
I think it's gone down significantly recently.
All right.
Because I know everyone at work who told me to buy into it is now really regretting it.
All right.
Oh, Wrecker and Hunter get back to the Marauder.
Yes.
Yeah, Hunter kills a bunch more people.
Well, Wrecker does shoot down
Wrecker
ships.
Kills
that's
right.
Femur Boy shoots down a ship. The old man uses a speeder to pull them up, and then Femur Boy. Not only does he walk on the broken leg,
that was so loud.
I'm just trying to get comfortable.
Oh, we can tell.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Just leave that in.
I'm going to edit the cursing out. That's it.
For listeners at home, about half hour ago, Thor picked up his laptop and was laying in his bed, and that was him adjusting to get comfortable.
On his New Jersey Devils.
New Jersey Devils pillowcase.
My mom made this for me.
Of course she did.
Did she really?
Yeah.
And honestly, it looks good.
It looks like it's store-bought.
Yeah.
Yeah, I should really sell her things.
She made masks for my boys during COVID. Batman and Superman masks. They were awesome. I'm never going to get rid of them.
Oh, nice.
I'm never wearing
them. Don't worry. We'll have another pandemic coming.
What's that?
We'll have a new pandemic coming. Throw those masks out.
All right. Brian.
So then the credits roll.
Your job.
Yeah, honestly,
they escape. On track, okay?
Spoiler alert. Yeah. They escape. They get on the ship. They leave Romar.
The old man gives her the kaleidoscope before she gets on the ship.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was a really important part, except nobody gives a shit.
I knew this episode was going to be like this, Brian. We haven't been on in like a month. I knew this episode was going to be like this.
This is great. This might be the best episode we've ever done.
He's rolling around.
The kaleidoscope would have been cooler.
I just see him, and I think of Brendan Fraser as the whale just rolling around in that bed.
Whoa.
Oh, shit. All right, there we go. Oh, man. Yeah. Welcome back, Star Wars. Hey, Star Wars, they're doing us real good for all the people that promote their show for free. How many podcasts have these kind of things going on when they talk about the after show, right? They do it at the kindness of their heart because they love the show. So you know what we're going to do for you guys? We're going to have 6 episodes overlap with The Mandalorian. Thanks.
It's not a big deal.
Yeah. No. You only work 13 hours a day, so we should be able to get it in with no problem at all.
Mm. There'll be some weeks where I'm off. Who knows?
Well, then Mike better learn how to talk, otherwise we're not going to have a
show. Who is Mike? You keep bringing up Mike. I've never met Mike. This is a stranger.
Well, just pictures of you and him together at that unbelievable Star Wars thing we went to in New York City.
No, there's not. It was me, you, and Thor. You keep saying Mike was there, and there was no person named Mike there.
And the greatest thing ever was Thor at the end of that thing. Hey, to this poor lady who's just working behind the counter selling lightsabers, and he's like, you know this was horrible.
No, he didn't say this is horrible. He's
terrible.
Like, yeah, so this was pretty terrible.
Yes!
I have to tell somebody. It's just eating me up inside.
It couldn't have just been us.
No.
It was a very weird deal, man. It really was. It was. I'd hope for so much better, you know? But it's okay.
Right, bad batch.
Bad batch. Okay, it ends. That's it.
It ends with Rampart. He shows up.
Oh!
And he reads the official report. And he's like, okay, we're going to change that because... Clone Force 99 is dead.
And Tarkin can't know that they're alive because that's a major screw up by me, and we can't have that happen.
Mm-hmm. And the Captain Wilco was like, I'm not going to falsify a report. Yeah. So Rampart just shoots him.
Yep. Right in the face.
Yeah.
And he falls off the building. Mm-hmm. Did you notice that little detail?
Yeah.
Okay.
You mean like pulled out really far and a body fell off of the building? I caught that.
Well, I was watching on my phone, so it was a very little.
Oh, yeah. Okay,
it's a little easier when you see it on TV.
Yeah.
I also liked all the clones were, like, just base color. Like, so either...
I thought they were looking cool.
Yeah, it was nice to see, like, a clean Phase 2 clone.
Can we talk about that for a minute?
Yeah.
I don't know how much has gone by. She's clearly older, so I would maybe say a year, year and a half, something like that.
Yeah, I'd think so.
Okay. At the end of the season, we start seeing them rolling out the TKs. And the whole show was about how we don't want to use the clones anymore. We're going to use the conscripted soldiers. But we have a whole squad of clones, so is it just taking that much longer to phase them out, or did they put a pause in the program? I like to know what's going on. I almost figured that we were going to be seeing... Stormtroopers in this season.
It takes time, man. It takes time to recruit
and train all these people, especially they had an army of clones. How many? 500,000?
Did they have that many?
Something like that. 500,000 with a million more on the way. I think that's the line.
Oh, okay, yeah. But how many actually left after the Clone Wars, and how many did they make during the Clone Wars? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, so it's got to be a time-consuming process.
I mean, it's not the first, like, the first time, and I'm not sure if it was canon or not canon, but Battlefront, the first go-round of the games, not 2015, but the first go-round, in the story mode, the 501st Stormtroopers couldn't wait to battle in Hoth because it was their first payback for the brothers that they lost on the Star Destroyer. They were clones at that point. Still, I know it's changed a bit that deep into the thing, into the movies. But I could see that. But I actually did think though when we got here we'd see more. I mean, this is two episodes, so who knows? And I also, big rumor is this third episode coming up is supposedly really good. So we'll see what that's like.
Sure, I'll believe it. I'll believe it when I see it.
Yeah, I know. I mean, well, the first season you enjoyed, didn't you?
Yeah. I mean, I liked it well enough. I'm so glad, like, especially watching the first two episodes here, I was surprised how excited I was to see these characters back.
Yeah, okay. Connor's gone back to the last season of Clone Wars. That's, like, his favorite thing in the world.
And, it's a good – well, yeah. I mean, aside from two episodes, it's a good season.
Four.
Is there four with the
four in the middle? Yeah, with the sisters. That's a little weird. Yeah. The four in the front are good, and the four at the end are tremendous. But yeah, his buddy now is they're both diving deep into the Clone Wars again, and then he says after that he's going to do Bad Batch. So we'll see. You have any other thoughts on it?
That's it. There wasn't a lot of like nods or winks or Easter eggs or anything.
No, not a lot of lore either, too. This is very, like, moving it forward, kind of like a side mission kind of thing. Like, we gotten a couple times, you know, during the rewatch, I thought it was less filler than I thought it was the first time around. And I think that's because you see the things that are connected, so, but it's still filler. I don't want to care. There's still a lot there that didn't need to be there. You could trim it down, but they want to do 16 episodes, so that's what you're going to do.
I'm sure it's like they have to fill X amount of time on the schedule for Disney Plus.
Oh yeah, just wish they would have filled it in November so we wouldn't have the crossover like we have to do.
Wow,
did he just leave?
Think so.
All right. Okay. Well, got a next episode in a couple days. See what's going on there. I haven't seen like a huge. I know that I've seen the one trailer. Palpatine's in it. I don't remember much of the trailer, so I'm trying to see if there's, you know, I know the crabs, they were in the trailer. So
yeah,
you know, usually the trailer doesn't give you a lot of the future anyway. But
yeah, there's Rex. There's Cody in it talking to Crosshair.
Cody is the big deal. That's right. Yeah. Now Cody's talking to Crosshair, so he's still with the Empire.
Yeah, well, okay. He tried to kill Obi-Wan, so he better still be with the Empire.
That was way back when this, you know, when it worked right away. It might be wearing off now. I don't know. So. And I'm sure they're going to do missions for Rex, so that's cool. Okay, well, now that Thor is back, we're going to get ready to say goodbye.
Jesus Christ. What? Whatever.
Okay. All right. Well, guys, thanks so much for joining us. I knew this show was going to be a little crazy coming back the first time. Thor hasn't been with us in a while. We are up to some cool things for 23, really. Brian's on top of it. We have a lot of shows coming out. He's been doing nothing but all kinds of show notes on all these kind of topics. And you know it's the 40th anniversary for Return of the Jedi. And I know Thor doesn't want me to commit to doing a year-long thing for anything, so I won't. But I plan on doing a lot for the 40th anniversary of Return of the Jedi, because I love Return of the Jedi. It's the one I remember the most, going to see in the theater and waiting online to go and see it. And it was just, it's a balls-to-a-wall sick movie. And I know people want to say, oh, it's another Death Star. Who cares? It's fun. The editing in that movie is some of the best editing to this day between the ground battle and inside the Death Star and with the lightsabers and then the ships. It's insane. George's best thing is editing. He's just sick at it. All right, so you know where to find us. You know we're on Instagram. I'm posting stuff. I did that thing I told you I was gonna do, Brian. I'm gonna put it up next week. I shot everything inside my fireplace with the Mandalorian, so it's like season 3 of the Mando going back to Mandalore, where it's just nothing but rubble and ash and everything. And it looks really cool. And I put some pictures up probably like 2 weeks ago of the set that I got, the rescue set, and there's a lot of cool stuff in there too, so we'll keep that going. Leave us a review if you can for Spotify and Apple. It helps us out, and we're going to figure out sometime in 23, and I say that probably we'll figure it out by December of 23 when we're going to put our merch on and do something different with that. So, but I really appreciate you guys listening to the show. We'll be covering this stuff, and we're not going to just be doing after shows. That's not what Boring Conversations is about. We're going to be doing topic shows, and we're going to be doing just cool stuff that we want to talk about. That's just what it is, talking about Thor's
King Kong and Thor's noisy bed.
But that is the most obnoxious noise. I mean, the bed is 9 times too small for him, and it makes more noise than anything on the planet. But all right, guys, why don't you say goodbye to everybody?
Goodbye.
All right.
Good night.
Brian, is nothing you want to sell us on about watching anything?
Yeah, go watch the 1946 film serial, The Crimson Ghost.
How'd you check this out?
That is where the logo for the band The Misfits came from.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I knew I knew that somewhere.
Oh, cool. All right. We'll do that then.
No, you won't.
No. That being said, guys, thanks for joining us. And go make some droids!